attention, you're so fine.
You're looking real good.
I was wondering if you like a drink. Don't worry, baby girl, it's on me. Get what you like. I just wanna get to know you. By the way, you got the name of Slip. Whoa, it's nice to meet you.
Yo, what's going on, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Mack Lessons Radio Show. And I am your gracious host, Mr. Tariq Elite. Glad to have everybody tuning in. Today's show is brought to you by MackLessons.com. That's where you can step your game up, get all my pay-per-view specials to satisfy your Macking needs. The Tariq Elite DVD, live in Atlanta. That's going to be out in a couple of weeks, so you guys stay tuned for that. Also, I got another project that I have coming out, people. If you guys listen to the show, you know I talk about this book called Black Players. I've always promoted that book because a lot of my players, they ask me for book recommendations. And this is one of the books that I always recommend. And the Black Players book, it was a book written in the early 1970s by these two anthropologists in the Bay Area in California, Christina and Richard Milner. And what they did, they went around the Bay Area doing interviews with all these old school pimps and some of the younger pimps too, but they had all these pimps that they were doing interviews with, and they compiled all the interviews and they had this book called Black Players. And the book is absolutely excellent. And the book has been out of print for like 20 years. The book has been out of print for a minute. And online, the book cost about $500. If you go to Amazon, the book is $500 there. The book is about $400 or $500 on eBay. You can only get it from certain collectors. And some people have paid that money, but a lot of people don't have access to the book because it's so expensive, because the book is rare. And I've been telling people I have an announcement, but the announcement that I have, I bought the rights to that book. I bought the rights to the Black Players book, and I'm putting that book out within the next 2 weeks. I've been telling folks I had a big announcement, and that's a big deal because that book is loaded with game. When I say that book has deep game, that book has deep-ass game from old-school players. They even have a rare interview in the book with Iceberg Slim. So I'm putting that book out on King Flex Entertainment. The book is coming in a couple of weeks. We're getting everything prepared, but I bought the rights, and I'm telling you, and the book is going to be very cheap. The book is going to be under $30, so I'm going to make it very affordable for everybody. And you gotta get this game. This is old school, straight lace Mackin. And this book teaches you about man-woman relationships, because it talks about the essence of the pimping. Because a lot of folks, you know, when they think about the pimping, they get thrown off. But this book really tells you a lot about man-woman relationships. It's a very, very good book. Black Players, The Secret Life of Black Pimps. That book is coming out, King Flex Entertainment, in a couple of weeks. So you guys stay tuned for that. Anyway, now today's show is going to be a very good show, as all my shows are. All my shows are very, very good. Today's show, I'm going to talk about weekday Mackin. Mackin throughout the week. How you should schedule your Mackin. But before I get into that, let me touch on a couple of other topics. The Bishop Eddie Long thing. A lot of folks are still talking about Bishop Eddie Long down in Atlanta. He was accused of having sexual relations with some of his younger church members, younger male church members. Everybody knows about that. And pretty soon, in a couple of weeks, I might do a show about the black church. A lot of people want me to talk about that, talk about the impact of the black church in the black community. And I think that's a very pertinent topic. So I will do that pretty soon. But did you guys see that, the response? Did you guys see Bishop Eddie Long this weekend? He did a response at his sermon. Did this nigga have a S-curl toupee? I swear to God, I've never seen an S-curl toupee. Where in the hell do you get an S-curl toupee? And do you put the activator on it before or after you put it on your head? Why is this nigga rocking an S-curl toupee? And some days he rocks the toupee, some days he does not rock it. I mean, that toupee is moist as hell in more ways than one. How are you going to have a bald spot one day and have bangs the next? That nigga had Jerry Curl bangs. So you don't, if you're trying to let motherfuckers know that you're not gay and moist, don't wear no bullshit ass toupee. That toupee was moister than the accuser's. God damn. How you have a moist toupee? That toupee had a life of its own. Shit. I would like to, you know what, I got a phone interview. Hold on. I think the toupee is calling in right now. We have an exclusive with Bishop Eddie Long's Jerry Curl toupee on the phone. Now, what do you have to say, Bishop Eddie Long's toupee?
Well, obviously, we have a rapist in Lincoln Park. He's climbing in your windows. He's snatching your people
Okay. Now, Bishop Eddie Long's toupee, can you describe Bishop Eddie Long?
He was about 5'9", 5'10", coffee complexion. He had a low cut like a Caesar with some little waves in his head, clean cut, very smooth face.
Okay, that's enough. But anyway, y'all tell Eddie Long, if you go to his church, take off that damn S-curl toupee. That makes you look guilty than a motherfucker. But I digress. Now, also, let me talk about something that happened on my Facebook page a couple of days ago. Now, all you people out there, you guys should have me on your Facebook. If you don't have me on Facebook, my Facebook address is facebook.com/TariqElite. TariqElite. Now, I was doing Ustream the other day, and when I do my Ustream shows, you know, it's anything goes. We talk about a whole variety of topics. We talk about a lot of historical stuff. We get into a lot of history, so we chop up a lot of game with my conscious brothers. And somebody on Ustream, they asked me, they said, Tariq, is it true that they had black popes in Rome? And I let the audience know. I said, of course, not only did they have black popes, they had black bishops and black saints, and hell, they even had black emperors in Rome. And I directed them to one of the emperors, one of the most famous black emperors of Rome, which was a guy named Septimius Severus. So a lot of my players were doing research about Septimius Severus. And they were posting some of this information on their Facebook pages about African emperors in Rome. And a couple of historians or pseudo historians were contacting some of my listeners trying to challenge them on that. And I was telling my listeners, if any historian or anybody wants to challenge the notion that there was African emperors in Rome, have them contact me. I would be glad to show them all the proof they need. So I was directed to this discussion on the Glenn Beck Facebook page. Glenn Beck, you know who Glenn Beck is, the Fox News guy, the crazy conservative. He has a Facebook page, and I got into a debate with some of his listeners, some of his Facebook people, about the validity of Septimius Severus being a non-white African. And the conversation was very interesting. Let me read a couple of excerpts from it. It's very interesting what happens when you have your facts straight and you start proving your point. Sometimes the conversation turns left. So I was debating with these guys, and they were saying, well, Septimius Severus wasn't black because he was a Punic and Phoenician background. Now, a lot of these right wingers, they'll try to throw these terms out there and try to throw you off like you don't know what they mean. Now, I know what Punic means. Punic is Carthaginian. We're still in Africa with that. And Phoenician, that those are the Canaanites and all that. So we're still dealing with black folks. And I let them know. I said, look, the Phoenicians are black. Now, let's not pretend that they weren't. There were some black Phoenicians. So then they tried to change up their argument. And it was a couple of them I was going back and forth with. And this is the typical argument of a lot of these right-wing cats when they try to expel some type of white supremacy when it comes to history. They say, well, the Phoenicians and some of the North Africans, they were of Semitic background, but they weren't Negroid. You got to watch terms like that. When they start saying stuff like Negroid and Sub-Saharan, that's another thing that a lot of people, what I call Eurocentrists, they'll try to talk about Sub-Saharan blacks being different from North Africans. That's a bunch of bullshit. And I want you guys to realize that. When people start talking about a Sub-Saharan black, that's not a real term. That was some shit that was made up by Eurocentrists. There's no such thing as a Sub-Saharan African. There's no such thing as a quote-unquote Negroid race. You understand that, people? Always keep that in mind. reject that sub-Saharan African shit. So there's one of the guys on the Glenn Beck page. He was like, well, yeah, they were the North Africans. They may have been dark skinned, but they weren't of Negroid race because the Negroids are the sub-Saharans. And I let him know. I said, and the conversation was very respectful, with no name calling. I was just hitting them with facts. And I let them know that Africans traveled all over Africa. So there's not one sub-Saharan race because there are people in West Africa who look like blacks and Moroccans, and they look like blacks in Ethiopia and blacks in southern Egypt. So they're different looks all over Africa. So there's no sub-Saharan race. The Sahara Desert was not a boundary to keep culture and intermarriage and all this stuff. There was that the Sahara Desert was not a boundary to keep people away from each other. And I also told them that the term Negroid race and even Caucasian race, that was something that was created in the 1700s. So then they tried to regroup. So then they came back. They said, okay, well, look, what does it really matter about race? Then they start trying to cop a plea. They were like, obviously, this is beyond my realm of meaningful contribution. Then they start trying to back out. They said, well, we should all just not look at race like this. I said, wait. Before, I didn't let them cop out. I kept on them. I said, well, look, you guys posted a topic. You said that this guy was not African. I wanted to prove that he was. And if you don't want to talk about race, you shouldn't make a topic about race. So you shouldn't contribute to a topic about race. When somebody starts proving you wrong, you should respect that. Then I hit them with a link showing them some footage from museums and some information from museums showing the African presence in Rome. And I was just getting warmed up. I thought that, you know, we were going to go the distance with it. So after I hit them with the link showing them about the African presence in Rome, then they hit me back and the shit took a left turn. Then they got mad because I proved their asses wrong. They came back with this. They said, well, Tariq, I really don't give a shit. So don't try to assert your supremacy over me. Does it make you feel better about yourself that some old crone who has turned to dust a long time ago was black or not black? History was written by those who win the wars of life. Clearly by your name, Tariq, it sounds Islamic, and you must hate white people, and you probably hate me because you think I'm an infidel. So you can take all that crap and shove it up your ass. And after you do that, please remember to pick up your pants and not have them sag. So then they got into some real crazy racist rant. And for the next post, they just kept making all these crazy racial stereotype rants. So when they do that, that means that they lost. When they get into the racial shit, that's a smokescreen. And if all my players out there, if you debate any of these guys and then you get one up on them and you start proving them wrong, they immediately go to the race shit. Then all of a sudden you are a nigga, coon, buck, tom. Then it gets into some bullshit, which is hilarious to me. I love it because when they do that, that means they lost. That means they have been backed into a corner. And I don't get into that name-calling bullshit. If you want to get under their skin, don't get into that name. They got a million names for blacks, so that don't mean shit. Hit them where it hurts, and it hurts when you hit them with history. That's when you get off in their asses. And that's why a lot of you cats got to know your history and get up on game, because they try to intellectualize racism. You understand that? And don't let them get away with that shit. You got to get on their asses with that bullshit pseudoscience and pseudo-history that they try to throw. A lot of black folks would take all that shit they say as face value. And I know what they're saying is bullshit, and I know how to call it out. And there's a lot of other brothers who know how to call that shit out. And you need to start doing that, because it's deeper than what you think. Man, you guys need to look up something called the American Renaissance. That's a magazine. It's a real far-right magazine that a lot of you guys don't know about. And it's like a movement. And these guys, they're very professional. They, you know, look like regular conservatives. They wear their little business suits and all that. But these cats are real off-the-hook racist with their ideology. And they try to hide their racism behind pseudoscience. They have this whole thing where they try to talk about blacks being genetically inferior. And these guys go around the country doing lectures at different hotels. A lot of people protest some of their conferences around the country, and a lot of their conferences have been canceled. But the average black person don't know about these guys. So you, some of the guys who run this thing is a guy named Jarrett Taylor. You guys should do your research about him. There's another guy named Phil Rushton. That's one of the main ones. And they have a whole bunch of books talking about how blacks are genetically inferior to whites, and they try to have all this quack science to back it up. And they got YouTube videos about these guys too. You should know about these dudes. And see, the teabaggers, they show all the dumbass teabaggers with the signs and all that shit on TV. The teabaggers are harmless. They're just a bunch of broke hicks running their mouths. I'm looking at these American Renaissance dudes. These are the ones you really need to look at, because they're not holding the signs and just talking about blacks this, and they're not talking all the crazy overt racist stuff. They are trying to intellectualize that bullshit. And that's more dangerous than anything, because these guys get funding from colleges and all that. So you guys need to be very aware of the Phil Rushtons and the Jarrett Taylors and the American Renaissance movement, because they use all these cute little terms, these innocent sounding terms, but it's a very racist agenda. So you guys got to get very familiar with that, because they're real good on talking. They like to show SAT scores between American black students and American white students. And there are a lot of, and they like to say that American black students, their SAT scores and their IQ scores are much lower than whites. But what they, and they try to say that that's somehow genetic. They leave out all the social implications that causes the lower IQs and the lower SAT scores. It's really social, because what they leave out is that people from Africa, African immigrants, they come over here and they outperform everybody academically. African immigrants are the most educated people in America. They kind of leave that out. So a lot of their shit can be refuted. You just got to be on top of your game. Shout out to all my African players out there. A lot of my African players, they've been sending me emails. My African players are disciplined with their shit. They stay on top of their game. And I'm going to go on to Africa in a couple of months. I'm going to probably go to Ghana or South Africa. My African players are on top of their shit. They're very disciplined. See, that's why a lot of American sisters don't like African dudes. Because African dudes, they're very structural. They believe in the man being on top. They don't play that matriarchal in the relationship shit where the woman is running them. So a lot of American black women, y'all don't like dealing with them African dudes. Well, one reason African dudes will whoop your damn ass. A lot of you sisters out here in America, you can't talk that slick shit to one of them African cats. Them African cats will get smooth off in your ass. Real quick, you come home to an African ass whooping. You be like, what? He's choking you and shit. Mufasa, why are you choking me, Mufasa? He going off on your ass. Who is that nigga you were text messaging? Who is that nigga you were text messaging? Stop choking me, Mufasa. I wasn't text messaging nobody. You a goddamn liar. Who is that nigga you were text messaging? Why you hit me in my ears, Mufasa? Stop it. You know, y'all sisters know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all sisters been abused by an African boyfriend. Stop pulling my hair, Mufasa. Who is that nigga you were text messaging? I'ma call the police on you, Mufasa. You can't call the police on no African dude. That shit don't work. African dude don't give a shit about you calling the police on them. You be on the phone, 911. I need to report domestic violence. Stop joking me, Mufasa. 911 operator, how can I help you? My ex-boyfriend is choking me right now. He's doing African jiu-jitsu on me. Somebody send somebody. Who is that on the phone right now? Who is that on the phone? He'll get on the phone with the cops and threaten the cops. Who is this on the phone? This is 911 operator. Do you want a piece of this? Do you want a piece of this? African, you know what? African dudes never go to jail. African dudes, I never seen them go to jail. They have all types of political connections, because I've never seen an African dude from Africa get arrested. They be on the phone talking shit to the cops. I have diplomatic immunity. I can whoop ass anytime I feel. But I digress. Shout out to all my African players. I'm not saying all my African players are abusive. I'm not saying that. But y'all don't fuck with them African dudes. Mufasa, he done hit me in my ears. He done pulled my tracks out. Can you spell his name yet? Mufasa Chekwele. I don't know how to spell it, but just come get this nigga up off me. Who is that nigga? Anyway, but I digress. Are we ready to get into some game? I've been bullshitting. Let's get into some game. All right, we're going to get into some game right now. Today's show, like I said, we're going to talk about weekday Mackin. Mackin throughout the week. All right? So this is what I want my players to do. This is like an assignment. I want you guys to set aside at least 1 week for some hardcore Mackin. Just one strong week for some real good Mackin. Because, see, a lot of guys go out periodically. They might go out all the time. They might not go out at all. But what you should do, you and your buddies should set aside 1 week, at least 1 week out of the month, and just do some hardcore game spitting, hardcore strategic Mackin for 1 week. And you should plan your whole day out like this, because you have to understand the importance of certain days. See, some game works better on some days than others. See, a lot of guys just stick with the weekend to go out, and that's pretty much it. But you got to utilize every day of the week, because it's very important to understand how every day of the week can help you get your game crisp. Now, we're going to start off with Friday. Now, truth be told about Friday night is really not the best macking night. Now, I'm not saying throw Friday night out the window, but Friday night is really not the best night for macking. Like, for me personally, Friday night has never been my night. I've never... Every blue moon, I might have a cool Friday night, but me going out on Friday was just not my night. Friday has always just been an off night for me, and it's an off night for a lot of players. But again, I'm not saying that you can't. Now, there's some players that do good on Friday night, but generally, Friday night is not the best night for Mackin. And let me tell you why. Now, Friday night, or Friday in general, that's when everybody gets paid. All the girls get paid. A lot of people get paid. Everybody gets their money on, so they're excited. So Friday, girls get off work. They go get a new outfit real quick, go get together, go get their hair together. They get into what I call Cinderella Diva mode on Friday. A lot of women have been chilling throughout the week. Now they've gotten themselves all done up, and now they got to have this attitude to go with it. So now they're in this diva mode, and they're really in the mood for getting a lot of attention. So a lot of women go to attention whore spots where they know a lot of dudes will sweat them. They're not really looking for quality. Friday night, women are looking for quantity. They just want a bunch of people looking at them. Because all throughout the week, they were real low key. Now it's like, this is their performance day. Friday is a performance day. You feel me? Also, what messes up a Friday, all the trick niggas and all the thirsty dudes, they've gotten paid, so they're out tricking like crazy on Friday night. Friday night is a real big tricking night. So Friday night, you got a bunch of cupcakers, simps, and tricks buying drinks like crazy because they got a pocket full of money, and they're out here making it rain. They're showing out with their money, the check that they just cashed. So if you got some real good Mackin in you, that's a lot to compete with. You got to weed out all the attention females, then you have to compete with a bunch of simps and tricks. So Friday night is real iffy. And again, I'm not saying that you can't put no good game down, because it can happen, but you just have to keep in mind that there's a lot to deal with. So keeping that in mind, what you should do on a Friday, you should go to a real laid back spot on Friday. You should go to like a jazz club, a bar, or a lounge, somewhere that's real, that has a laid back vibe. Something that has a real party vibe is just going to be a bunch of attention whores and tricks. So you don't want to waste your time on that. So Friday night, my players, we're going to go to a laid back spot. Go to a poetry reading, something real laid back. Got it? Now that's Friday night. Go to a salsa club, something real laid back. Salsa clubs, they're fun, but they're laid back because people have an agenda, which is to do the goddamn salsa. So the vibe is a little more fun and you can put some good game down, but don't go to one of the real jumping spots where there's a bunch of attention freaks and all that. Now let's go to Saturday. Now Saturday is attention whore night times 10, because now women have had all day to get dolled up. They had all day to go to the mall. They didn't picked out two or three outfits to decide from. A lot of women have they gotten their nails done, they have gotten their hair done. So now they're really dolled up, and now they've gotten all their buddies. So it's a whole bunch of them going out. That's when women go out in bunches on Saturdays. Now they have their crew with them. So you can use that to your advantage. I'm going to get on that a little bit later. So now Saturday night, all the clubs are packed. But the thing is, you have a bunch of women in a pack, and they try to compete with one another subconsciously. So you use that to your advantage. So that gives you an edge, so to speak, because there's still going to be a bunch of tricks and simps out. But you have more women to go around. So now it's a numbers game. There's a lot more women that's out on Saturday night, especially running in packs. Now, on a Saturday night, again, you don't take it too seriously because there's a lot of that bullshit attention whoring going on. So what you should do, players, on Saturday night, you should have at least 3 clubs lined up. Saturday night, have at least 3 different clubs lined up that you can go to. Because, again, it's like playing craps in Vegas. You put a number of bets on the table. So if you lose one bet, you have this other bet that you can make money off of. So it's a numbers game. It's an energy game. It's a vibe game. So if you go to one club, too many attention whores, you leave that club and go to another spot. If the women are not cooperative, you go to another spot. And I can almost guarantee you that you're going to get some good energy out of one of those spots. So Saturday night is club hopping night. You got to club hop because a lot of attention whores, a lot of tricks, a lot of packs of girls out there. So you got to move around a little bit Saturday night. Now, let's take it to Sunday. Now, Sunday is a little better because, see, Sunday, a lot of girls spend time with their families. A lot of girls spend time going to church in the daytime. So they come down off their diva high. They're coming down off the Cinderella high. They become a little more grounded on Sunday. So now they're getting their minds right a little bit. But they still want to get their club on because, you know, they done kicked it with their family. They got one more night, they got to go to work the next day, so they want to get their little club on one more night. Also, it's Sunday night. They know this is the last night of the weekend, so they might be a little more selective in finding a dude with some good game. So Sunday night, which has always been one of my best nights, Sunday night is, that's my shit. I'm a beast on Sunday. I'm a Sunday Mac all day. I've done very well on Sunday nights because Sunday nights, the girls are looking for some real good game. Now they're looking for some decent conversation because, you know, women wait till the last minute to kind of cram for the test. So they wait till Sunday night to get some real good game from a dude because they've gotten all the attention Friday and Saturday night. They've had all the simps buy drinks and talk whack bullshit to them. Now they want to hear some good shit. They want to hear some good game. So Sunday night is perfect for that. So when all the knuckleheads step to women, they kind of brush those knuckleheads off on Sunday. So they're looking for quality on Sunday. And you, if you've been listening to the show and studying the game, you're supposed to have quality game. Got it? Now, remember, Saturday, Sunday, and Friday, you're passing out a lot of cards when you're talking to women. You're passing your cards out. You're campaigning very heavily. You're being courteous. You're doing a lot of grenade macking. You're stepping to different girls in the club, hitting them off with your card, exchanging numbers. And Sunday night, you're doing a lot of this as well. Now, when Monday comes around, Monday is a choosing day. This is what you do. Fellas, never call women on Monday. Listen to what I'm saying. Players, you never call women on Monday. Because Monday, you let the women call you. If they call you, everything is all gravy. But you never call women on Monday because on Monday, all the other simps that these women have met, they're blowing the women's phones up. All the simps and the tricks, they are lighting these girls' phones up on Monday. So you don't want to even be in that bunch. So you're going to chill unless the woman calls you. And trust, women give their numbers out nonchalantly to different simp ass dudes. There's probably some dudes that have bought them drinks, so they feel like, okay, it's a polite thing to give this motherfucker my number, but they don't take those guys seriously. Also, Monday, a lot of girls are coming off their weekend diva club high. A lot of them are still bragging about how many dudes they met. They're bragging about how much fun they had. They're bragging about how many guys were sweating them. So you got to let them come down off that club diva high on Monday. Now, Tuesdays and Wednesdays, these are the best days. Because Tuesdays and Wednesdays, that's when women are back into normal mode. You got it? Now, Tuesdays and Wednesdays, she's out of that whole diva mindset. Now she's back at work. She's back at school. So now reality has set in. So now her mind is back to normal. Her mind is right. See, a lot of these women, they've sweated out their little hairdos that they got for the weekend. A lot of their nails are chipped. So they're not on top of their game 100%. That doesn't mean that they're not fly. But they're not all as dolled up on a Tuesday or Wednesday. Women are very laid back. They got their hair pulled back. They're not wearing as much makeup. So everything is very normal. So it's best to step to women when they're in normal mode. Because their minds are right then. Also, Tuesdays and Wednesdays are best times to go out on like lunch dates or dinner dates with women. So if you are going to call a woman, which is cool. Me personally, I don't like calling women, but I let them call me. But if you are going to call a woman, you definitely do it on Tuesday or Wednesday. And then you set up a time to hook up either that night or the next night. You don't want to set up a date for her on the weekend. Don't do that. You want to hook up with her that Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday night. Let her do a weekend thing. Because again, weekend is attention whore time. But if you hook up with a woman, try to do it on a Tuesday or Wednesday. Because they're going to be more cooperative on a Tuesday or Wednesday. They're real cool on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. Now, our last day, Thursday, if you're not on a date with a woman, which, again, that's what your objective is to do, to set up a date Tuesday or Wednesday for a Thursday night. Now, if you don't have a date set up, you use Thursday for some daytime macking. You have to start spitting game at girls in their everyday settings. You got to start hitting up the girls at the gym. You got to start going to the supermarkets and putting your game down. Thursday, girls are still in regular everyday mode, and you have to utilize that to your advantage. Start hitting up, go to different corporate places where they have lunch breaks. Start spitting at girls on lunch hour. Like if you go downtown to any metropolitan city or any place in the country, at around 12 to 1 or to 12 to 2 o'clock, you see a lot of women out going on their lunch break. You start hitting their asses up. Hit them up at gas stations. Hit them up at the mall. Hit them up at the Walmarts. Hit them up at the damn Jamba Juice or Target or wherever they are, but do a lot of daytime macking. Holler at the girls in their everyday normal settings. Exchange numbers with them. Chop up game with them and set up dates for that night or the Monday or Tuesday of next week. You got it? So that's how you use your game throughout the week. That's how you should have some tight, straight lace weekday macking going on. So you guys remember all that. Put that into your repertoire. And remember, weekday macking is some of the best macking you can do. The weekend is really for just practice. The weekend is a practice session. Your strongest macking is going to be, from Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. That's your strongest macking day. So keep that in mind, players, all right? Anyway, y'all, that's been today's episode of the Mack Lessons Radio Show. Thanks for checking out the show. Don't forget, go to MackLessons.com to check out some of the pay-per-view specials. I will holler at you guys next week. Peace.